I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Open your mind. Exercise your imagination. This week, Stanton Forbes' labyrinth of tropical intrigue. But I wouldn't want to die there. Starring Nehemiah Persoff. Brock Peters. And Marge Redmond. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by Chevrolet Trucks, Cold Power, and Sign Off. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Ever put together a jigsaw puzzle? Begin with the pieces that have a flat edge. They form your perimeter, the frame. From there, work inward, turning each piece to examine all possible angles. A good puzzle has several pieces cut to nearly identical shapes. This checking and counter-checking is tedious work. But soon things begin to fall into place. You begin to get the picture. Whole sections fill in, until you've only the last few pieces remaining. This week's tale is a real puzzler, a story within a story, a winter's tale of summer past. Come to the Caribbean islands, visit exotic St. Martin, say the brochures, where it's summer all year round. Quite a temptation if you're spending January in New York City like Sylvia Bennett. But she's already been to St. Martin, and one visit was enough. She could never go back, not after what happened. Though even now those last pieces don't quite fit. But that was over. Much has happened to her since. The decree finalizing her divorce, a new job, a new apartment. And now her mind was made up. For Sylvia Bennett, New York in January was perfect for suicide. For Sylvia Bennett, St. Martin is a nice place to visit. But I wouldn't want to die there. Our story begins after this word. Picture this. Snow is falling on Manhattan. January thaw is late in coming. A yellow taxi spins around the corner at 103rd and West End and settles to a stop astride a brown snowbank piled high on the curb. A woman steps from the passenger side out into the ice and slush. A handsome woman of 42. Her expression is one of bitterness. A gust of wind off the Hudson River swirls the virgin snow into her determined face as she struggles her way indoors.
Oh, New York, I despise you so. I must leave instructions. If found, please ship in a plain pine box to anywhere far away. Regards, Sylvia Bennett, deceased. Damn, you're so slow. The mail. Why not? Let's see what bills my estate will have to pay. Con Ed, Lord and Taylor, telephone company. What on earth? Postage due 14 cents? Saint-Martin? More travel guides? No more trips for Sylvia. No more bills. No more of this hideous planet. And this time, no slip-ups. Damn it. They'll have to break the door down to get me out. There. Next step. Good, stiff belt of scotch. Right here on the living room rug? Nope, too messy. A bullet in the brain. No gun. The window. With my luck, I'd land in the snow, break my back, and live. God, it's quiet. I wonder. All these pages. Dear Sylvia, don't throw this away, please. The way I look at it, you owe it to me to read it. I spent a lot of time writing it down, and the least you can do is read it. I deliberately didn't see the papers when it was all over. I suppose I should have, but I just didn't want to see what they said about us. That's the kind of coward I am, but then you know that. Damn it. Can't you people let a wretch die in peace? Hello.
Hi, it's Carl.
I know, I recognized your voice.
How have you been? How's the new job?
Ghastly, thank you, to both questions.
You didn't have to leave Day, you know. Divorced people do work together. It is done.
But Day is your magazine. I'm just a reporter, remember?
I'm worried about you, Sylvia. You won't do anything foolish.
I'm a big girl now, and I'll thank you to mind your own business.
Now, hold it. What the hell's wrong with you, anyway? You were getting along all right. We could at least be civilized, and then... Ever since you got back from that island, the past 6 months, you've been... What happened? Do you need money?
I told you before, I don't want your money.
Sylvia, you...
No, I'm not crying. It's just this damn cold. Look, nothing happened. I just got sick in the gut, that's all, of everything.
If you need someone to talk to...
No, thank you, doctor. These four walls will suffice. They listen rather well, you know. I've nothing more to say to you, Carl. Goodbye. There. No more interruptions. You've written a novel. Oh, what terrible handwriting. Tad, what the devil have you done? Oh, dear Sylvia. That's the kind of coward I am, but then you know that. I had to set things straight.
You'll forgive me if I don't have much faith in newspapers and magazines. But set it straight to whom? People wouldn't believe me anyway. That's when I thought of you. That's one of the times I thought of you. Anyway, I've told it the best I can. I start with that day last summer when all hell broke loose on Saint Martin. I was taking my evening walk along the beach. It was a dark night, though once the sun goes down, all nights are dark to me. I don't see well without my glasses. I should say I hardly see at all. I'm a congenital myopic anyway. Since I've covered that ground so many times out where the pier juts out along Molly Smith Point, I knew where I was. What I didn't know was what I would find. A body. A woman's body. Hello? Who? You there? Are you hurt? Oh, my God. Oh!
Help! Somebody! Anybody come quickly!
What's up, Mr. Cobb?
Alphonse, there's a woman here. I just fell over her, I think.
Why is the famous actress, Mr. Cobb?
She looks bad. Her head is all smashed up.
Is it Miss Lee?
Will you call these men from the river? Cowboy, they hear you too. Sound like you're hurt.
No, I'm all right, Wong. Shine your torch over here.
Oh, my God. Oh, Mrs. Lee. Yeah, she looks dead, Mr. Cat.
Who's it? Inspector Clark? Is that you? Cal Wallander here.
It's Annabel Lee, the actress. She's been badly hurt.
We were about to call you. She may be.
She's dead.
Dead.
Very.
She's up. What is up?
Count the tracks here. See? We are all standing in our own.
I'm afraid I can't see what you say. You see my glass?
There are no other tracks, not even her own.
What about the tide, Inspector? Couldn't it have washed them away?
Monsieur Cadwallader, the tide is coming in.
But then how? What could have happened?
At the moment, monsieur, who's to say? But I believe, I am not certain, you understand, but I believe that Madame Lee was battered about the head with some variety of very obstinate material.
Battered? You mean on purpose?
One cannot say for certain just yet, Monsieur Cadwallader. May we? It appears that Madame Lee was murdered.
It took me a long time to fall asleep that night. I couldn't get that terrible image out of my mind. To quote Poe as best I can, the beautiful Annabel Lee in her sepulcher there by the sea, in her tomb by the sounding sea, lying there in the surf in her white bathing suit. Her head, oh, a terrible sight, awful. I keep a supply of very potent sleeping pills on hand for just such emergencies. I took 3 that night, which was more than I'd used for since the days when... Well, but Sylvia, you must know what day, what years I refer to. I needed the pills then to survive. This time, I hoped if I slept deeply, I would awaken to find it was all just a bad dream. Lord knows how long Eloise, our maid, was knocking, trying to rouse me before I stirred.
Monsieur Pat! Monsieur Pat!
Eloise! What's the matter?
The gendarmes, Monsieur Pat. The gendarmes are here.
Oh, yes. Yes, Eloise. Tell them I'll be right down.
The lounge was nearly deserted. Inspector Leclerc was waiting for me. With him was a certain Captain Dubois, who looked very official indeed. They were accompanied by Gerard Bonaventura, a diminutive fellow with big owl eyes and big round glasses. Gerard was owner and editor of the Island Voice in Saint Martin's only newspaper. Do you know yet was she murdered?
Even now, Dr. Fortier is conducting his post-mortem.
Have you been able to reach her husband?
The guests in the house, Bates, I believe is their name, have sent a cable to Puerto Rico. They are trying to reach Mr. Lee by telephone as well.
There is no Mr. Lee. You see, that was her stage name. His name is Tolliver, Robert Tolliver, very big in New York advertising. A genius, I read somewhere. He sold his business last year and retired.
Excuse me, Mr. Card. Eloise say you need new handles on 2 windows. You drive me to Marigot for them?
Yes, as soon as these gentlemen are through, Alphonse.
For the moment, we are through. Fini. Your presence will be required should we have an inquest.
I understand. Come, I'll show you out. If I can help in any way, I'll be here, of course. And Gerard, you will spell my name correctly. 2 L's.
Do not worry. I have all that you say right here, Mr. Cad.
I must admit, I admire Alphonse's nerve as a passenger, the way people drive on Saint-Martin and the roads between the potholes in the grade and the livestock crossing at will. It's a virtual obstacle course. And I must remind you that my eyesight isn't all that it could be. If Alphonse was frightened, he camouflaged it well.
When is Mr. Max returning? Watch out, Mr. Card. How's crossing up ahead? Mr. Max will be surprised that he missed all the excitement. Careful, Mr. Max.
Max told me at the airport he'd be back by the end of the week. He had to order some new mattresses and...
Look out for that dog, Mr. Card.
I'm sure Max will spend a couple of days living it up. You know how he is.
Yes. Mr. Max likes the ladies, eh? You handle the business while he plays.
I wouldn't say that exactly, Alphonse. Max is just, well, you know, women prefer a man with a beard to a fat old fogey like me.
Oh, you're not fat, Mr. Card. You just have a lot of skin.
Thank you, Alphonse. You put that rather well.
Mr. Card, Mistress Lee promised me a present, but she never gave it to me. A yellow wig with long curls for the carnival next year.
You ask Mr. Tolliver about it when he gets home. Not right away. Wait until after the funeral. I'm sure he'll give it to you.
But why can't I ask Mr. Robert for the wig right away, Mr. Card?
Well, he'll be very upset about his wife's death. He'll be very, very sad for a while.
Oh, I don't think so, Mr. Card. He used to hit Mistress Lee real good. Make her cry, make her eye black all the time.
What? Did you tell that to the gendarmes?
The gendarmes? Of course not, Mr. Card. They didn't ask me.
La
Lunch was being served on the terrace when Gerard Bonaventure stopped by looking very excited.
Dubois and Leclerc are questioning all over town, going door to door. They think now it was done in a boat, that she was pushed over the side into the water.
Why in a boat?
Because of the tide and lack of footprints. Dr. Fortier has determined the time of death between noon and early evening.
That's a lot of time. Couldn't he do better than that? It seems to me it had to happen at night. Surely someone would have seen her get into a boat in broad daylight.
It is strange. No one saw her all afternoon. The American couple, Bates, they were in Philippsburg all day shopping, and Maria Lisa, the maid, she was at the dentist for her teeth that are not so good. They all come back to an empty house. But I think somebody must have seen. That was a very good-looking woman. The gendarme will find out nothing from the people.
I think you're right. No one wants to get involved.
I shall go to each house, too. This is the mark of a professional reporter. Yes, the people here are my friends. They will tell Gerard more than they tell the gendarme.
I went to bed early that night. You may not believe this, Sylvia, but I had a dream that a lovely woman would soon enter my life. I took my coffee on the gallery the next morning. Across the street, I could see the gendarme's jeep parked in front of Annabelle Lee's house. I wonder who could be coming to Grand Case in a taxi.
It's a woman, Mr. Card. She's coming here.
Undoubtedly an American.
Pretty woman, too.
Oh, she sure knows how to walk. I'll say that.
Well, I have to go now, Mr. Card. I'll see you later.
There's a lady here wants a room.
Very well, Eloise. I'll be right down.
Poor cat. I had you charmed before I ever saw you. She knows how to walk. That's a laugh. Oh, if things had only been like they seemed to you. Had I come to get away from it all like I told you. But that wasn't the reason. It wasn't all a lie, though. I did come over from St. Croix. Carl and I were as good as divorced. He was vacationing in Christiansted. I knew the hotel. We'd been there often enough as husband and wife. I kept telling myself I wasn't chasing him. We were all sitting together at poolside. Carl, those three vacant but beautiful young women, and good old Sylvia, when we heard the news.
Sylvia, you knew Annabelle Lee.
I interviewed her a couple of times.
I've got a terrific idea. San Martin's the next island down. Get on a plane and see what you can find out. The innocent tourist bit. Try to find a spot to stay in the village where it happened.
I don't know why I took the assignment. Perhaps to convince Carl that I was better than those stupid women. Those cheerleaders. All bust and no brain. So, I knew how to walk. What next, Cad? I decided to go down
onto the beach. I didn't do that often, not at midday. My new guest was there. You, Sylvia. Wearing a red low-cut swimsuit and white bracelets that sparkled in the sun.
Are you going to sleep, or would you like some company?
I'd welcome company. Mrs. Bennett, is it?
Oh, Sylvia. This is my first visit to San Martin, and I don't know a soul.
Well, I'm Jeffrey Stamp Cadwallader.
Oh, my, that's a mouthful.
People call me Cad. It's an odd name of endearment. I've gotten used to it. Those are pretty bracelets you have.
Oh, thank you. They're turquoise. Rather common these days. They used to be chic. Who lives over there?
Annabelle Lee. I should amend that. She lived there once.
The actress? Oh, didn't I hear somewhere that she'd passed away?
As a matter of fact, I found her right over there by the pier. A terrible thing.
You know, you've got the prettiest place on the beach.
Mm.
How did you find it?
My partner, Max Terry, found it. I can't take credit.
Your partner?
Yes, he's a very nice man. You're sure to meet him. He's due back from Puerto Rico any day.
Mm.
How would you like to have lunch with me?
Oh, I'm so sorry. I've already eaten. Oh, I ordered a cab to take me over to Phillipsburg to do some shopping.
Well, then how about cocktails, dinner?
Oh, I'd like that. Say about six?
About six.
Poor Cad. You are even more blind than you imagined. And I was so ruthless. Oh, I went to Phillipsburg that afternoon, all right. But not to shop. I went to the telegraph office and wired St. Croix asking for information. Somehow, I was perplexed and frightened by a big teddy bear of a man with thick glasses. He reminded me of someone. A face in the newspaper. And the name, Max Terry. Suddenly, while looking at my own reflection in those tinted eyeglasses before leaving the beach, the names and faces crossed a span of 25 years. I was fresh out of journalism school. My first assignment, a murder case. Helen Terry, 14 years old, pushed to her death off the rooftop of her family in Queens. She had a brother, Maxwell, in his middle 20s. And he had a friend, a heavy-set, myopic friend who was found guilty as charged. But the other name, not Cadwallader, but Johns. Joseph Johns. Oh, Cat, I had to do it. Please forgive me.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense. But I wouldn't want to die there.
I'm Rod Serling, and this is the Zero Hour. There's something relentless about a jigsaw puzzle. Once it's begun, it dares you to continue. It has a gluttonous effect on time, altering, consuming the very hands of the clock. For Sylvia Bennett, time has become a precious commodity. She has selected this day to be her last, and a puzzle is what she needs the very least. It came in the mail, a letter, or rather a manuscript, from a man named Cadwallader, or perhaps Joseph Johns. It's a puzzle of intrigue with borders of tropical green and deep Caribbean blue. What may be a boat we have forming in one dark corner, and beneath that the scarlet tinge of a beautiful woman's spilled life's blood. The picture is murder. The puzzle begun. And somewhere hidden within the remaining irregular shapes lie the pieces that will form a face. That face is the key, for it is the face of a killer. But I wouldn't want to die there, continues after this word.
The morning of the second day. The sun was setting behind Molly Smith Point. It seemed particularly brilliant, hot orange, pink
and gold. We watched it set, saw sky and sea turn to shades of purple. Remember? I studied you, Sylvia. You were lovely as a painting.
Cadwallader. That's an unusual name. I've heard it somewhere. One of Salinger's people?
How do you like Alfonso's special concoction? We call it No Big Thing. Somewhat of a misnomer. I'm afraid it's rather potent.
No, that was Stradladder or something.
Tell me about your ex-husband.
Touché. Shall we be friends? Tell me, Mr. Cad, what do you hate? Personally, I detest accordions.
So do I, and moray eels.
Bad grammar, pretty men, too elegant women.
Women who... No. People who talk too much. Liars. I hate liars. Unless there's a good reason, and they do it well.
Hey, Cad, I'm back. What the hell's been going on?
Who's that?
That's Max, the brains of the outfit. I'll introduce you. Max, I'd like you to meet Mrs. Sylvia Bennett. She's taking a room with us.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Can't I leave you alone for a couple of days without the sky falling, Chicken Little? It's all over the San Juan papers. Annabelle Lee, dead.
Yes, I found her.
Excuse me, I have to go to the ladies' room.
You feeling all right?
I'm fine. It's no big thing.
Cam, now listen, there were reporters on the plane back. You know what this will mean.
We'll probably do a booming business.
You know what I'm talking about.
Max, you just got back. You're tired. Maybe you should rest a while.
Cam, wait. I've got to talk to
Later,
you.
Later, I've got a date for dinner. Eloise, have you seen Mrs. Bennett?
She's out on the terrace, Monsieur Cad. She asked me where you are and could I bring two more No Big Thing. I bring them now?
Very good, Eloise. Thank you.
Monsieur Robert is outside, too.
Annabelle Lee's husband?
Oui.
I want to see you, Cadwallader.
Mr. Tolliver, I didn't expect to see you so soon. Please let me offer my condolences.
Never mind that. I want some straight information on what happened to Annabelle, and I want it now.
I'm sorry, but someone is waiting for me on...
They can wait.
I'm afraid they can't.
Look, I'm sick and tired of getting the runaround.
Just what the hell do you mean, Tolliver? You've got a lot of nerve barging in here, shooting off your mouth that way.
I mean Cadwallader found my wife. I got some fairy tale from a French cop about your friend out beachwalking. Well, he's going to have to do better than that.
Look, I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Cad, you don't have to put up with this garbage.
Cool off, Max. Everybody's all wound up. I'd like to hear what Mr. Tolliver has to say.
I got plenty to say. For openers, I think you were making it with Annabelle. Or trying to. She wouldn't put out, so you clobbered her.
Wait a minute. Hold it, Max. I don't want him in here.
Take it easy. Take it easy. He's wrong.
Now look, you're wrong. I've only spoken to the lady when you've both come in for dinner. Besides, why should she be interested in a fat old man like me?
Because Annabelle was interested in anything that wore pants. Not only that, she complained about a peeping Tom, she said, when she was getting dressed or sunbathing. Somebody's nasty, she told me. Somebody's got a fouled up mind. Well, Cadwallader, I think that somebody is you.
And I suppose you didn't beat her to a pulp every Sunday and twice on holiday.
You can't talk to me
Sit
like...
Sit down, Max!
Shut up, Cad! I was in San Juan.
San Juan isn't the other side of the world. You ever hear of chartering a boat? A plane, maybe? Oh, how about a hitman? Goodbye, lady. Hello, fat bankroll. How do you like that picture, Tolliver?
Now, you son of a...
Hey, monsieur! Enough.
Leclerc.
Perhaps Monsieur Tolliver should eat his dinner at home. The cuisine at the gendarmerie is not so good.
I'm going. But I'm not satisfied, Cadwallader. You're going to have to come up with a better story. I've got ways of finding out what really went on.
The moment our hostile guest was escorted out, I went to find Sylvia, but the terrace was deserted. I cursed my bad luck and Tolliver's bad timing and began nursing my third no big thing. Somebody slipped out from the shadows behind me and breathed in my ear.
Is it all right, Mr. Card? I go for the gendarmes. Did I do right?
Oh, Alphonse.
Oh, Cad, you couldn't have known what I was really up to that night. The drinks had gone to my head, but not to the point my hearing was impaired. I stayed until the police arrived, then crept off to my room. I wanted to fall asleep, to shut off my memory, but I couldn't. Johns and Terry, together. I hadn't remembered Max Terry as being such a brute, an angry, hairy gorilla of a man. And the coincidence that I should have come to Saint Martin to research another murder. I don't know how long I lay there in bed, not listening, but hearing things. Hello? Is someone out there?
Max Terry, Mrs. Bennett.
What do you want?
Just checking the cistern, Mrs. Bennett. Anything I can do for you?
No. Thank you.
Good night, then.
Cad, why are you telling me this? Why now? Why today? Oh, I suppose you must... And you're right, I do owe you this much. So, what happened next? The morning of the third day.
I overslept again the next morning. When I went downstairs, there was no one in the dining room except Eloise. And when I asked her where everybody was, she said Mr. Max had gone to buy groceries, the Bings had flown to Saba, a neighboring island, for the day, and Mrs. Bennett had gone to pick up a telegram. Then she told me Rose Phillips wanted to see me. It was urgent. After coffee, I went to see her. What she had to say was more than urgent. Why she chose to tell me, I couldn't figure at first. You see, on Saint Martin, we have what one might call peculiar alliances. Loyalties among relatives are inviolable, and since most everyone is related to everyone else, well, Rose Phillips had sworn a solemn oath that she would not tell what she knew to the gendarmes. She left that to me. I drove to Marigot quickly, but carefully. I parked across the street from the main gendarmerie, crossed over, and entered the rather imposing building. Before I had the chance to ask to see Inspector Leclerc, he appeared. It was almost as if he was waiting for me. Leclerc came out through an inner door accompanied by a chubby-faced, stockily built man who was practically trotting. The man looked straight ahead on his way out. He never even saw me. He looked familiar, though I couldn't place him. As I said, I had the feeling Leclerc was expecting my arrival. I didn't see him look my way before he spoke.
Ah, Monsieur Cadwallader, what brings you to Marigot?
Inspector Leclerc, could I speak in private, please, with you?
Certainly. Come into my office, won't you? Won't you kindly sit down? What is it I can do for you?
Well, I've learned something I think you should know.
Yes?
Robert Tolliver was back here on the island for a time the day his wife, Annabel Lee, was killed.
Ah, yes, we know.
You know?
Certainly. One of our first duties was to investigate the whereabouts of Madame Lee's husband and Monsieur Max Terry as well. The gentleman who just left, that was Emmanuel Patterson, the ticket manager from Carrie Bear. Monsieur Patterson has corroborated the report that both Robert Tolliver and Max Terry were passengers on the early flight to San Juan. Monsieur Patterson also reports that Monsieur Tolliver flew back at 3:30 the next day, then left again for San Juan at 5. Customs records agree. That is how we know.
I see, yes. Well, I should have realized...
Robert Tolliver was driven to his house by Clement Turbot on Turbot's cab. Mr. Tolliver says he came to get a check necessary to consummate a business matter in San Juan that afternoon. We are pursuing this last matter further with the American authorities and the Puerto Rican hotel where Mr. Tolliver was staying. This far, his narrative seems basically valid.
Well, I just thought...
We are also pursuing, as a routine matter, the corroboration of Max Terry's visit to San Juan. He stays, I believe... At the Primavera?
Yes, it's a guest house, not unlike our own in Grand Case. The concierge is a lady friend of Max's.
Ah, yes. A Miss Anita Castellano. So you see, Monsieur Cadwallader, we are almost as efficient as your American forces.
Yes, of course. Well, sorry to have bothered you.
Oh, no bother at all.
When I arrived back at the guest house, there was a young man I'd never seen waiting for me. Perhaps I'd come to possess what one might call look-look-voyance. I knew not who the man was, but I was sure of why he had come and what he wanted.
Mr. Cadwallader, my name's Boland. Joseph Boland. I'm a newspaper man from the States. I wonder if you got a spare room.
I'm afraid...
Where the devil is Alphonse? This thing weighs a ton.
Well, I'll only be here a few days.
Eloise, take this stuff, will you? You're looking for a place to stay?
I'm Max Terry.
Max, this is Mr. Boland. He's a newspaper man.
Oh, over here for the Lee business, I imagine.
Well, there's a bunch of us on the island, but most of them are holed up in Phillipsburg. I thought if I could find a spot near the scene of the crime... Here are my credentials.
Hollywood, eh?
Well, the thing is, this could be a big break for me. Annabel Lee was very famous, you know, especially on the West Coast. You'd be doing me a tremendous favor if you'd put me up.
Don't see why not. Do you care?
Well...
Let me take your bag, Mr. Boland.
I don't know if it's such a good idea to have a newspaper man staying here. Do you, Monsieur Cad?
Oh, I guess there's no harm in it. Let me help you with those, Eloise.
Well, I don't know about harm, but he could find out a lot of things about Grand Case that maybe we'd like it better if he didn't. That's all I was thinking about, Monsieur Cad. That is all. Let me think. Well, that must have been the day I went shopping. Oh, Sil, you're such a good liar when you want to be. Carl's cable with the lowdown on the Joseph Johns case had come. If this was the same man, if Cad was Johns, if this was another of my million-dollar hunches, Cad, poor teddy bear.
I found you in the shade of the front gallery. Hello, Cad. Isn't it a lovely day?
Oh, hi there. I missed you at lunch. Care to join me? I heard you went to town. Something about a cable.
Oh, yes, from my ex-husband.
Not bad news, I hope.
He's bad news. He wanted to come here, so I had to wire back. Dear ex, stop. Don't you dare stop, Sylvia. You think you'll get the message?
You're not very subtle.
No, I don't suppose I am. Who's over there? That fascinating old house.
Madame Bousquet and her son. The house is falling apart now, but I understand it used to be magnificent. Oh, look, there she is now.
She looks like quite a character.
They say she was magnificent, too, in her day.
Who's that bald fellow with her?
That's her son, Guy.
Is there something wrong with him?
Yes, he's retarded, not quite bright. There's another boy who lives in Puerto Rico. He's normal.
With the father?
No, Michel Bousquet lives outside of town. Have you met our newest guest, Mr. Boland?
No, I'm afraid I haven't. He must have just arrived.
This morning. He's from the States, a reporter.
A reporter?
Yes, you act surprised.
Not surprised. I knew it wouldn't take long. Annabelle Lee was a great star in her day. Won't the publicity hurt the tourist business?
Maybe, maybe not. But there isn't much I can do about it.
Oh, it's such a gorgeous day. Why don't you take me sightseeing before the place is crawling with newspaper people?
And where do you want to go?
Well, the Bings were telling me about a place called Benvenue. Where is that?
Oh, beyond Marigot on the peninsula.
What's it like? Tell me something about it.
Benvenue, a very strange place. No one lives there, not a soul. It's just there. It's the unfulfilled dream of an American developer. A few years ago, this American hired a French architect to design the plans for a city that would combine the past and the future, Mediterranean in feeling, with all modern conveniences of the jet age. Construction was begun. 3-4-story buildings, all built of stone, with walkways, courtyards, fountains. And then the money ran out. The crews left. They won't be back until someone invests another fortune. In the meantime, Benvenue sits and waits, all stone and glass and empty.
It sounds lovely.
It is, in a strange way.
Could we go there?
Oh, it's a bit of a drive. I don't really trust my eyesight.
I'll drive.
Very well. We'll take my car. I'll tell Max we're going.
Well, I want to get my camera. I'll meet you downstairs. Did you ever? Oh, I never would have dreamed this was here. Cad, stand over this way.
No, I'll ruin the picture.
No, you won't.
You handle that camera like a pro.
Oh, it's just a hobby. I adore color slides.
There's a spectacular view from the top apartment. You can see Marigot and Phillipsburg, both sides of the island.
Not Grand Case?
No, we're behind the hills.
How beautiful it would have been. Oh, won't anyone finish it ever?
Maybe, one day. If the money man finds another money man. You see, that's what they call him here. The money man.
Do you know him?
No, his name is Tanqueray. He hasn't been on Saint-Martin, so far as I know, during the 6 years I've been here. Somehow, I rather like this place. The way it is, the mirage.
Do you come here often?
Sometimes, when I want to get away. Well, have you seen enough? We'd best be getting back. Business was booming when we returned to Grand Case. You thanked me with a peck on the cheek and went upstairs to change. Considering this was the off-season, the place was really jumping. The Bings were back and had brought another couple with them. Bolin and Gerard occupied one table, and of all people, Robert Tolliver was there. He and the Bates couple comprised a quiet threesome at a corner table. I had my hands full just serving drinks.
Hey, Cadwallader. My friend Gerard here has been filling me in on the murder. You found the body, right? How about an exclusive? I'll give you name credit.
No, we're rather busy now. All I can tell you is what I told the police. I was out walking and stumbled across her.
Think it had anything to do with black unrest?
Black unrest?
Sure, all these islands. The natives are restless. We hear about it up in the States. Self-government, all that.
I wouldn't know anything about that. Talk to Gerard here. He's in this island. I just live here. Alphonse, I need one mint julep, a sling, and two you know what.
Say, Cad, come here. What did Boland want?
Oh, he's got a race backlash theory he's working on. Why did you rent him the room? He doesn't have to be here.
Oh, wise up, Cad. These guys can write anything. At least if he's here, we can try to win him over. Be diplomatic.
Thank you, Alphonse.
For any of these for Tolliver, I'd like to poison this.
Max, be diplomatic. People came and went all through the evening and night. The Tolliver party left early. We got rid of the last around 2 a.m. Max counted up the evening's receipts, slapped me on the back, and went off to bed. I must have sat there alone for a long time. I thought about you, Sylvia, about how pretty you looked that night. And for the first time in years, I felt lonely.
I sat alone, too, that night, Cad, up in my room, too busy to be lonely, working late into the night, just hoping you were Joseph Johns. Oh, Cad, you don't know what lonely is. You have people who care for you, who care about you. They care because you are kind, regardless of what you might have done in the past. I have no past, and I want no part of any future.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes. And listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense. But I wouldn't want to die there. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Chevrolet Touch, Cold Power, and Sign-Off. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow, and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Radio Network.